Hello everyone, this is Rahul Malhotra from SFDC Stop and welcome to the third tutorial in Salesforce integration tutorial series. So in this tutorial we are going to learn about the POST method in detail. So let's move on to our workbench, and as you know that we have created a custom API which is known as the contact API. So in this tutorial what I'm going to do, I'm going to add a new method in my contact resource class, that is create new contact. And I'm going to create a new contact using the POST method, or you can say the POST request to this method. So POST method is mainly used to create the data according to the HTTP standards. So let's jump on to our code. So what I have right now is the my contact resource class. It's the same class that we used earlier. I have a REST resource with a URL mapping of contact API so that I can use my contact API using this mapping. So whenever I'm going to, you can say, make a POST request to this URL ending with contact API, my method in this class with an annotation of HTTP POST will be called automatically. So whenever I'm going to select a POST request from the workbench and I'm going to make a POST request on this URL, Salesforce will automatically check all the methods with the class that is annotated with the REST resource having a URL mapping of contact API. And it will check that which of the method have an annotation of HTTP POST. This is because only one method can be created in the contact resource, or I mean in this class, in the custom API class that have an annotation of HTTP POST. So what I'm doing in this method is that I have four parameters. First is the first name, second is the last name, third is the birth date, and fourth is the lead source. So I'm doing nothing but I'm creating a new contact. Following the HTTP standards, I'm creating a new record. So I have just created an object of the contact, and I have set up the first name, the last name, the birth date by using date.parse method, because my birth date is coming in string in the input, so I am using date.parse to convert it into a date, date data type. So, and I am finally setting up the lead source of the contact, and I am inserting a new contact, and then I am returning the new contact in the response. So whenever I return something from this method, it will automatically be returned as a response body. So let's check out this method and let's see how it works first of all. So I'm going to send a JSON request body with my parameters. As if you remember, my first parameter was first name. So I'm going to add a first name as, let's say, Mike Wheeler. I'm going to add a last name also. So let's say last name. Let's keep the first name as Mike and the last name as Wheeler. So first name is Mike, last name is Wheeler, and next is my birth date. So let's say the birth date is what should I do? Let's say 4/9/1987. Okay, and let's say the lead source. Lead source can be web or phone inquiry. For now, I'm taking it as web. And let's click on execute and see what happens. Okay, I got an Apex error, invalid date. So the date format is not supported, I think. So I think I should use it like this, 1/4/9/1987. Okay, so this type of date format, the date.parse method was able to pass this date format. So this is how a record is created. I have the record ID of the new contact that is created. So let's check it out. AP5 is my Salesforce instance, and I'm going to put the record ID here. So let's see whether our Salesforce org has a new contact or not. So as you can see here, a new contact named as Mike Wheeler is already created in my Salesforce org. It has a birth date of 4/9/1987 as given by me. It has a lead source of web, and the first name and last name is set automatically. Okay, so what actually happened is when I set up the URL ending with contact API, I chose the POST method and I provided the details. These details with the name, first name, last name, birth date, and lead source are automatically mapped to my, you can say, method parameters. And then inside this method, I used these parameters and I created a new contact with the four parameters that I'm giving in the input. And finally, I inserted the contact and I returned the contact in the response. So I got my contact in the response. Even if I check the raw response that is in the JSON format, I can see that it is of type contact. and it has an ID of this, because whenever my contact is inserted, an ID attribute is automatically associated with it. So I'm getting the ID back in the response too, along with the other details that I sent or that were already associated with my contact object which was inserted. So using this ID, I have already checked it in my org that my new contact is created, and if I even check the creation date, it is of now at the time when I'm recording this video. Okay, so this is about whenever I have created a method and I have given some of the you can say parameters for the new record that I'm going to create. But what if I have a number of parameters? Suppose I want to create a record using the API and I have about 50 parameters, or I have about 100 parameters. So do I need to create all the 50 parameters here one by one, comma separated? And even if it is supported or not, I don't know about that properly, right? So I mean, I have tried this once, but I don't remember exactly. But what I remember is that around 50, I think 25, 50 parameters are supported by the method, but not more than that. Even 50 is much larger, I think. Around 20 parameters are supported or so by the method. So I mean, if only some of the parameters are supported, then what's the workaround for this? I mean, what is the other way we can do in which I can send a lot of data? Suppose I can send around a lot of parameters here, and all the records should have, the record should have all the parameters that I'm sending here, right? So what I have done, I have created another class which is known as contact resource one. It is on the URL contact API one. So let's change our URL to contact API one this time. And what this class is doing, it has also a method which is named as create new contact, which is annotated with HTTP post. So whenever I'm hitting this API, I don't need to specify the method here. However, I just need to specify the HTTP method I want to use, so that Salesforce automatically search for all the methods and link it to a method with the proper annotation. For example, right now I'm using the post HTTP method, so it will link it with HTTP post. So what I'm doing in this method is that I am initializing my contact request parameter of the REST request class using the request that is coming. So my REST contact class has the request and the response that is actually coming or going through my API, right? So this request, the actual HTTP request is initialized, is given to the contact request parameter of my REST request class. Then I extracted the request body and converted it into a string, because my request body is by default in a blob format. So I used the toString method to convert that blob into string. And I assigned my request body to my string variable, which is request body. Then what I have done, I have used json.deserialize method, because I know that my request body is coming in the JSON format. So I have used json.deserialize method, and I have given the request body in the first parameter. So json.deserialize method is used to deserialize the JSON. And in this method, what I need to give two parameters, where in the first parameter is basically the JSON string that I want to deserialize, and the second parameter is my wrapper class, or you can say the class which is of that type, so that if I serialize the class's instance to JSON, then it will be the same. Suppose I have created an object of contact, and it has fields like first name, last name, birth date, and lead source. So whenever I'm going to convert that contact object into JSON format, it will be like this, right? So my wrapper class should be of the same type, so that whenever I deserialize the JSON which is incoming, it should properly fit this wrapper class, or it should have all the, you can say, variables that are matching the class fields, or you can say class variables. So I have used the inbuilt contact class which is already there in Salesforce, because these are my contact fields which are coming in the request body. So I'm deserializing the JSON by passing the request body string in the first parameter, and the contact.class, that is my inbuilt contact class, as a wrapper class in the second parameter. So the deserialized JSON string basically gives us an object in the output, so I need to typecast it to my contact, because I know that object is of contact type, and I have finally initialized a contact variable using that. So what I have done at the end, I have inserted a contact and I have returned the contact in the response. It's the same thing that we were doing previously. So let's see, if I hit my contact API one with the same parameters, let's change the name to Mike one and execute this command, and let's see what happens. Okay, I'm getting an apex error. It is saying that cannot deserialize the instance of date of value string. Yeah, because my date because here I'm not using date dot parse, right? So my date data type in Salesforce is not able to recognize this date. So in this case, what I need to do, I need to give it in the same exact format as Salesforce stores the date in. So I can give it as 09-04. So if I use this format, then my date will be passed automatically and I will not get any error instead of this format like I was using before. Okay, so let's click on the execute button again and let's see that our contract is created successfully. It has a birth date which is in the proper format. So let's take out the new ID and let's see whether my Mike One Wheeler is created or not. So Mike One Wheeler contact is already created in Salesforce. It has a birth date correctly, it has a lead source correctly, and we have other fields also like department, title, phone, etc. So if I want to add other fields too, I can do that very easily. Suppose I want to add a phone field, so I can add phone and I can add some value to this like 90909090909090, and let's click on execute and let's see. Okay, my contact is created with the phone. So let's copy and paste the new ID here and check. Okay, so this time my phone also have a value. So if I want to add any other variable, suppose let's pick up the department. So I'm going to add a department as IT department. So let's add another variable which is a department. It has a value of IT department. And I'm going to click on execute. So these are the attributes that are associated with my new contact. My new contact is created. Let's replace the ID of my new contact here. And I can see that my department is also there, my phone number is also there, and all the other attributes that I added in this request body are there. So this is a better approach if you have a wrapper class or if you can use the inbuilt class that is present in Salesforce as a wrapper. However, you need to take care of some things like we face an issue while sending the date in some other format, because we need to take care about the data types that are already there in Salesforce because they accept data in the proper format only. So, I mean, when you are using a post method or you are going to create a record in Salesforce using your custom API, you can either do it. I mean, you can either do it by a way in which you can send the data in the parameters as a parameters, or you can directly pass the request body. By getting the request body from the REST request which is coming in Salesforce. So these are the two ways by which you can deal with the post methods. However, there are some things to take care of, like when I'm using Contact API 1, I need to take care of the format by which I'm sending the data, because I have used, I mean, it depends on the wrapper. I have used a standard class as a wrapper because so that I need to pass the data in the same correct format. However, if I talk about this, then there is also a limitation in the earlier method that we have done. So in the earlier method, if I just remove this phone and department for a while and I click on execute, then you will see that it is not working perfectly because the date format is again long. So let's do it like 0409, because I'm using date.parse here. Okay, so if I am using the previous method, then it is working here. However, if I remove one of the parameters like lead source, then you will see an error, probably. No, because the lead source is coming as null. However, if I do anything else, like if I change my birth date to birth date 1 and I click on execute, then I can see that there is a JSON parser error because the JSON is not able to parse. However, it is saying that unexpected parameter encountered during deserialization birth date 1. So there is no parameter in my method which is of the name birth date 1. So the Salesforce is not able to parse this JSON. So while using, I mean, what I wanted to say is that while using the parameters in the method, we need to take care of the thing that we should use the exact names as we have given in the parameters. However, while using the request body structure, we need to take care of the wrapper class that we are using. So that's all for the post method. It is mainly used to create new records like we have seen here. In the next tutorial, guys, we'll talk about the put or patch method in detail according to my series that are there. If I talk about the integration tutorial series, the next one is the delete method. So we'll talk about the delete method in detail in the next video. So if you like this video, just let me know your feedback in the comment section down below. If you want a detailed description, it is given in my blog. I will add a link of this blog in the description. So, and the rest of the thing, if you want to have a look at the code itself, then it's available in my GitHub repository. So you can just go to github.com/rahulmalhotra/sfdc-integration-tutorial, and you can go to the post branch where you can see all the code here in the contact resource class as well as my code in the contact resource one class. Okay, thanks for watching. See you next time.